Now we can discuss on the Likert scale and liability analysis. Likert scale is a powerful tool for social science research. Social science research is using Likert scale for measurement of attitudes, but the social science researchers are to be careful while using Likert scale. There are two school of thought. One school of thought that is ordinal school of thought, and the other school of thought that is cardinal school of thought. The ordinal school of thought saying that Likert scale is an ordinal scale, so we cannot use the parametric test, and the cardinal school of thought saying that Likert scale is a cardinal scale or interval scale, so we can use the parametric test for data analysis. Now we can see the origin of Likert scales. Likert scales were originally developed by Rensis Likert, a sociologist at the University of Michigan from 1946 to 1970. It was concerned with the measurement of psychological attitudes, and he was used for the same. And also the other social scientists such as Thurston, he had already developed a sophisticated method for measurement of psychological phenomena. But these were unsuited for Likert attitude research. So Likert, after trying various alternatives, gradually developed what we now call it as Likert scales. So it is widely used for the social science research and consumer researchers. Now, uses of Likert scale. Likert scales are widely used for measuring attitudes, attitudes of people. For example, the opinions of people and the psychic and mental dispositions of the people, preferences. So when we take the example of stock market, we can check the biases of the investors can be checked with the help of Likert scale. So the questionnaires and surveys based on Likert scales are used in various areas. In particular, the cervical approach introduced by Parashuraman 1985-1988 was his citations, has received enormous interest, and after that there was a lot of people, a lot of institutions used or using this cervical method for consumer researchers. So the cervical questionnaires used exactly the Likert scales as such. So the first school of thought saying that Likert scale is an ordinal measure. So that if the scale is an ordinal, or if the data is an ordinal, so we cannot use the parametric assumptions or parametric statistics. We need to use some non-parametric statistical test. So the Stevens in 1946-1941, his papers has pointed out that the Likert scales are the types of nominal, ordinal, interval, ratio in terms of permissible transformations. But the school of thought says that it is an ordinal measure. Scales consist of categories ordered by a relation of the type. So any two measure values can be compared in terms of the order relation. So it just says that the Likert scale is an ordinal measure. So now the second school of thought as a cardinal measure. Cardinal measure scales express magnitudes. Differences between the scales various values are meaningful, so that we can use the parametric assumptions, because the data which have collected by using the Likert scales are cardinal. The cardinal in Stephen's methodology, cardinal scales are interval scales. Interval scales are characteristics by the admissibility of strictly increasing linear transformations. So we can use the parametric assumption. For instance, the cardinal scales may be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 1 to 10. So whatever it the case, we can use it as a scale. So now we can discuss the most popular Likert scales. The most popular Likert scales are used by the social science researchers, such as 5-point or 5-grade Likert scales, or 7 grade or 7 point Likert scales. The grades scores degrees 1 to R are ordered in ascending order of agreement or approval of the individual with respect to the value statement. So in case of R is equal to 5, the grades are usually interpreted by strongly disagree, neutral, that means undecided, then agree or strongly agree. These are the 5-point scale. So the 5-point scale starting from the strongly disagree, which may allot a point of 1, and disagree which may allot a point of 2, and neutral is 3, and agree is 4, and strongly agree is 5. So that is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So now cervical approach. The Likert scale was popularized by Parshuraman. He introduced cervical approach. So cervical approach that was a concise multiple item scale with good reliability and validity that retailers can use to better understand the service expectations and perceptions of consumers. So in order to check the consumers feedbacks on the retailer side or consumers feedback with the industry side, which can be checked through cervical questionnaires. It was developed by Parshuraman. Attitude surveys structured according to the cervical approach introduced by Parshuraman, and the citations came up 1985 and 1988, are currently among the most popular applications of sample survey in industry. But this method, in fact, still it is working well. Most popular cervical manuals and case studies are scales with, the 7-point scale or 5-point scales. So occasionally the other values like 10-point scale are also used. See the citations of Ashbandek 1996. So now we can discuss the attitude measurement scales must satisfy the following criteria. A good Likert scale must follow or must comply some criteria. Otherwise, the scale we can say that the scale is not reliable and it cannot be used for the purpose of research. So these are the criteria. The first one, longitudinal consistency or retesting reliability. That means at repeated measuring times under conditions, the respondents exhibit the same rating. So when we collect data today and when we collect data tomorrow, we should be able to get the same result. That is a longitudinal consistency or retesting reliability. That is the most important criteria of a Likert scale. And the second one is longitudinal comparability, because the responses given by an individual at different times with respect to the same time can be compared on the scale. Because the respondents we get from today and the tomorrow, we can be able to compare it. So that is a longitudinal comparability. And internal consistency, it means the extent to which the items within the instrument are measures various aspects of the same characteristics or construct. That means the extent to which the scales measures various aspect of the individual or construct. So that means internally the scale should be consistent. And interpersonal comparability, responses from different individuals can be compared on the scales. So different individuals from different times can be compared on the scales. These are the four important criteria of a measurement scale. The first one we discussed, that is longitudinal consistency or retesting reliability. Second one, longitudinal comparability. Then the third one, internal consistency. And the fourth one, interpersonal comparability. There is a common error by the researchers while they are doing Likert scale. The common error one, Likert scale is never an individual item. So the researcher should be keep in mind that Likert scale is never an individual item. It is always a set of several items. It consists of several items. A construct under a construct a construct several items are checked with specific format features. Responses which are added or averaged to produce an overall score or measurement. So researchers should be keep in mind a Likert scale is never an individual item. It is always a set of several items. So the next slide will show the set of several items, example of set of several items, and the set of several items which specific format features, the responses to which are added or averaged to produce an overall score or measurement. So that is very important. A Likert scale is never an individual item, but it is a group of item, or we can say that under one construct there are 10 or 15 sub items or sub scales we can judge or we can measure with the help of Likert scales. So this is an example of a Likert scale. You can see that please indicate how much you agree or disagree with each of these statements. So these statements can be judged with 5-point scale, and the scale consists of strongly disagree, somewhat disagree, neither agree nor disagree, somewhat agree, strongly agree. And the statements are, this is the statements. The last slide we clearly pointed out that Likert is not an individual item but is a group of item. The group of item consists of the president is doing a good job. So you can judge either strongly disagree 1 point, and the somewhat disagree 2 point, neither agree or not disagree 3 point, and somewhat agree 4 points, and strongly agree 5 points. And the Congress is doing a good job. That's the points are also same thing, and the Secretary of Defense is doing a good job. So this is an example of a Likert scale. Okay. The last slide we saw the Likert scale. Now we can look on the Likert item. So a Likert item is extremely different from a Likert scale. Likert scale, you have seen 4 or 5 statements, and the statements were measured through Likert scale. Now here we are showing the Likert item. So Likert item, for example, how do you feel about the president's performance in domestic affairs? So this is asked through a question, and this question can be collected with a 5-point scale: strongly disapprove, somewhat disapprove, neutral, somewhat approve, and strongly approve. So this is a Likert item and a not Likert scale. Okay, the Likert item and Likert scale is different. Now we can look on the Likert type item. So the three things we have discussed: Likert scale, Likert item, and Likert type item. So all these three are different, and these three are asked in a different way. You might have understand that Likert scale is different from the Likert item. Now we can look on the Likert type item. So the questions are asked like, how often do you go out to see a movie? Never, sometimes, average, often, very often. This is an example of Likert type item. So this is an another common error which has been repeated by the research scholars. This is not a Likert scale or a Likert item or a Likert type item. This is not suitable for parametric test. So it should be eliminated. It should be avoided. This error should be avoided. How often do you smoke cigarette? Never, once in a while, 1 to 5 per day, more than 5 per day. This is like an ordinal scale, and this cannot be justified as a cardinal scale or a scale. So it should be avoided. This error should be avoided. So Likert scale evaluation. Most commonly, Likert scales are evaluated by giving each option value. And we experience that strongly disagree to strongly agree. We have given some values, and these values are the factors. Through these values, we are assessing the opinions. So then adding these values together. And for a Likert scale, you know that there are five or six statements, and these five or six statements were assessed, and we have to add these values together to create a score for every customer. Okay, so though relatively simple, this reporting method makes it easy to evaluate the opinions revealed by each Likert option. So this is a method. So we have to add the scale values together to get a common opinion. So this is the Likert scale analysis. For example, if we draw a graph with the help of a Likert data, so this is of a graph position, and sometimes, often, always, never, rarely, so we will get a conclusion from this graph. After evaluating the scale, you should be able to determine the areas in need of improvement, as well as areas in which your company is struggling. So such kind of understanding we will get from the Likert scale's evaluation. So most important factors in reporting on the Likert scale are consistency in values. That is very important for the proper assessment. So questions that are out of place can skew the result. If we ask some questions which are out of the way, or it's not like genuine questions, the result may be skewed, making it harder to take the right actions based on the answers your customers give you. So that time we are not in a position to assess the opinions of the respondents due to a skewed distribution will be the outcome of imbalanced questions in the questionnaire. So this slide discusses the possible survey distortions. You know, when we collected some opinions through Likert scales, some of the biases may happen due to the problem of questions or the bias of the respondents or something like that. So this is called as the survey distortions. The next slides we can look on the survey distortions. The most prominent bias is central tendency bias. So respondents may avoid choosing the most extreme options provided. So when we have always extreme options like strongly disagree or strongly agree, but unfortunately the respondents, they are not interested to give this extreme values. They will their respondents responses will be central oriented. So most common explanation for this tendency is that respondents do not have a clear definition of the extreme high or extreme low with regard to a specific question. How would you rate our company's customer service? For example, a question we are asking, how would you rate our company's customer service? With responses ranging from unhelpful to the extremely helpful, a customer who did receive exemplary customer service might get caught up in the semantics of extremely actual means. He don't know the definition of extreme. That means his respondents, the responses are central oriented. It is possible that although they acknowledge the service was exquisite, they are hesitant to report that it was. That means he would pick any of the neutral answers only. Another explanation for tendency bias is that customers might initially save up their extreme answers for later questions. In the beginning, they will be neutral, and they think like in the end part of the question, they can be like extreme. Okay. The second reason behind the bias is extreme response bias. Some of the customers, some of the respondents feels that their value should be extreme only. They are not in a position to select the neutral values. Even though their justifiable answer would be the neutral values, but unfortunately they are not in a position to select the neutral values. They always look on the extreme values. This bias is called as extreme response bias. This also should be avoided from the responses from the respondents. Then only we will get an accurate opinions. So this is solutions for avoiding biases. You know the reasons for the biases by the respondents, maybe the cultural attitudes of the respondents, maybe the intelligence levels of the respondents, maybe the level of effort respondents put into completing a survey. That is very important. Some of the customers are careless, some of the respondents are careless while filling the questionnaires or schedules. Their biased response may come up. And the fourth one, the way in which questions and choices are worded, that is also very important, the way in which the questions and choices are worded by the researcher. Of these four reasons, the only one the researcher can have a control over is the last one. The last one, that means the way in which questions and choices are worded, that can be effectively controlled by the researcher. The other three are beyond the control of the researcher, because cultural attitude is external to the researcher. The intelligence levels of the respondents also external to the researcher, and the level of effort the respondents put into completing a survey is also external to the researchers. So the researcher should be careful about the fourth one, that is the questions and wordings of the questions. So the researcher should ensure the questions you ask don't lead respondents towards a certain answer, and also that each option is clearly defined and understandable. So the researcher should always keep in mind that the questions asked don't lead respondents towards a certain answer, but it should also that each option is clearly defined and understandable. Thank you.